Oh, we come to worship the Father. We come to worship God in the beauty of holiness on tonight. So wonderful to be back in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. He's watched over us all day long. Bless us to make it back into the house of the Lord one more time. Oh, yes, Father God. If you would, if you're able to, we would ask everyone to rest on your feet. Those of you who can, we would ask you to rest on your feet. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you right now. We thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercies. Thank you, Father, for your loving kindness toward us. Oh, Lord, we humble ourselves before you, realizing that it is in you that we live, move, and have our being. It is you who have created us and not we ourselves. We want to say thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. Thank you for being a good, good Father. Thank you, Father God, for how you continue to watch over us throughout the day. Thank you for allowing us to make it back to the house of God one more time. Oh, Lord, we need you on tonight. Hallelujah. We don't know what one another has faced, Father God, but we thank you that you've covered us on today. We thank you that you've protected us on today. Oh, God, we thank you for being here, Lord God. We ask you to bless those who are yet on their way. Bless them to make you here safely, rebuking the hand of the enemy. Lord, we want to say thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you for the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross, for the remission of our sin. Thank you for sending a comforter who is the Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, he's the one that proves us. He's the one that comforts us. He's the one that guides us. He's the one that leads us into all truth, Lord God. And we realize that it is the truth that makes us free. And we thank you for being free in Christ Jesus. We thank you for the victory that comes through Christ Jesus. We thank you for salvation that comes through Christ Jesus. We want to just say thank you, God. We just came to praise you on tonight. Dwell in the midst of the praises of your people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, just have your way. In the name of Jesus, watch us through your word is our prayer, Lord God. Anything that's not like you, show us ourselves on tonight. We want to be conformed to the image of your Son. By the time the service is over, Father, we want to look more like Jesus, talk more like Jesus, act more like Jesus, Lord God. When people see us, we want them to see Jesus. Let us, Lord, be your hands. Let us be your feet. Let us be your eyes. Most of all, let us be your heart. Lord, change us on tonight. Convert us. Transform us. Lord, we refuse to leave this place the same way, Lord God. Heavenly Father, look over every need right now. You know every situation. You know those that may be dealing with any stress or depression. Those that may be wrestling with something right now. Strengthen your people right now is my prayer. Oh, God, give them strength to continue to fight the good fight of faith and to lay hold on eternal life. Oh, Lord, we thank you for true leadership on tonight. We ask you to look over our pastor. Continue to strengthen him in this last day hour. Give them the wisdom that he needs in order to lead us, your people. Yeah, Lord, we will follow him. We thank you, God, for everything that's going to take place. Send your word on tonight. Save somebody's soul on tonight. Deliver somebody from the bondage of sin. Fill with the Holy Ghost is our prayer. Heal, deliver, and set free. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on and lift those hands and give him praise on tonight. Take a few moments and tell him something. From the fruit of your lips, worship him. Open up your mouth and say something on tonight. Express your love. Express your gratitude. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you on tonight. We love you, Lord. You loved us first. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at somebody real quick and tell them, neighbor, it's good to see you back in the house of the Lord. Oh, look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, I made it. I survived. When the enemy came in and tried to take me out, hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord lifted up a standard against the enemy. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, I'm still here. The devil tried to take me out, but I'm still here. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, I'm covered by the blood. Come on, somebody ought to talk back to me. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, are you covered? Are you covered? Are you covered by the blood? Hallelujah. Yeah, Lord. Look toward heaven and just say, Lord, have your way. Have your way in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on and give us a song.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Bible said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Did anybody come to praise the Lord on tonight? Did anybody come to bless him on tonight? Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, he's been real good to me. I have to bless him. I will praise him like it's my last time. Come on and clap your hands for a moment. Musician, hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
let me hear the tambourine. Come on, children. Hey, put those hands together.
Let's praise the Lord.
Let's praise the Lord.
Let's praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Come on, come on.
Give him glory.
Let's
praise the Lord. Give him praise.
Oh, hallelujah. Come on, come on, come on. We got a right to bless him on tonight. Oh, hallelujah.
Let's praise the Lord.
Yes, God. Sounding real, real good out there. Yeah, Lord, you're worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Yes, he is. Thank you, Lord. Come on and put those hands together for your brothers and sisters in Christ on tonight. The ones you can see and the ones you can't see, the ones we not gonna meet until we make it to the other side. You know you got other brothers and sisters that you won't see until you make it to the other side. Put them together for our pastor. First lady, the pastoral assistant, Elder Adrian Autry. Now put them together for Jesus. I said put those hands together for Jesus. Somebody call his name. Hallelujah. Something about the name of Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Oh, how I love the name of Jesus. He's the one that saved my soul. My God, we thank God for Jesus on tonight. You may be seated. We're moving right along to our testimony service. We're going to call for our brother, our dear friend, our brother, Brother Mathis Howard.
Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Amen. First, I do give glory and honor to God, my Savior Jesus Christ, our pastor, Apostle Herman L. Mary, Lady Danielle Mary, to my precious wife on tonight. I just first and foremost just thank God for being saved, sanctified, filled with his precious Holy Ghost. I appreciate God just for being faithful in my life. I was just thinking about the different many ways and testimonies that God has just been so good to me. And I know we have a short period of time, but just even just on the way to church tonight, we just, Erica and I, we were just talking about how faithful and gracious God has been to us, and just seeing the different accidents and hearing on news report people dying instantly. And it just took my mind back on, unfortunately, we were involved in a couple of accidents in less than a year. And we came just barely with some small injuries, and we just thank God for just that. And the goal of it was you have to be ready at all times. She had mentioned that, yeah, you don't have time to say nothing. And one of the accidents that we were hit from the back, and you just didn't see it coming. But I thank and I magnify God for bringing us out of both accidents. But it was just a reminder that we have to be ready at all times and prepared to meet the Lord's face in peace. I thank God for that testimony on tonight, that being ready. I often tell people, I'm prepared, but I'm not ready, meaning I want to stay here longer. But if he was to call my name, I thank and I praise God that I would see his face in peace. I just thank God for being the Savior of my life that he's been. I thank him for being a need meter, a way maker on tonight, just the small things that sometimes we so often forget about. I just thank God for being able to stand before you, take breaths from the breath of God, his breathed breath into my lungs. I appreciate God that I don't need any help walking around. I know people younger than me that can't get around. I appreciate God just for everything that he's done in my life. I appreciate God. I know every day has not been Sunday, but I do thank God for the Mondays, because it always reminds me that I have to put my trust in him. I do ask the righteous to pray my strength in the Lord.
Beautiful testimony. Sound like he's thankful on tonight. And many of us, we always want to know, what is the will of God? You know, if you go through the word of God, it'll tell you what the will of God is. And one will is, the Bible says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. And so my brother here, he just testified how thankful he is. And all of that is part of the will of God. Put those hands together for that testimony on tonight, how God has just been truly faithful to the Howard family. We thank God for our brother. Amen. We're moving right along. Somebody say, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Stand to your feet as we present to some and introduce to others our dear sister. Bring on with a round of applause, Sister Nika Shedd.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. You may be seated. The pulpit has already been addressed. My topic is what my salvation means to me. And my scripture will be coming from John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. My salvation means everything to me, because if it wasn't for the love of God sending his son Jesus for me, I wouldn't be where I am today. And that is saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. I thank him for choosing me back in July 2018. He looked beyond every fault and saw my need. He knew I needed to be delivered from depression. He knew I needed to be delivered from wanting to fit in. He knew I needed to understand the true meaning of love. He knew I needed to understand what it means to truly be saved. I left God calling myself trying to experience the things in the world because I was always at church, but God had other plans. He let me know that nothing I needed was in the world, but it was through salvation. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. The things I used to do, I don't do anymore. The places I used to go, I don't go anymore. The lies I used to tell, I don't tell anymore. The words that I used to say, I don't say anymore. The things that I used to wear, I don't wear anymore because God changed me. And I don't have a desire to go back on God. I thank God for my salvation. There's so many benefits in serving God. And we know we don't serve him for the fishes and the loaves, but we serve him because we don't want to see his face in peace. We see our salvation mean everything to God because he sent his son to die on the cross for our sins. He knew no sin, but he became sin for us. He paid a debt he didn't owe, so we owe him our lives. Romans 6 and 4 says, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. We buried the old man. This means we are able to walk in newness of life. We are dead to sin, but alive in Christ. Colossians 1 and 14 says, in whom we have the redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin. It was his blood that washed away our sins on tonight. Romans 10 and 9 says that if we will confess with our mouth and with our mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I was reminded that I had to repent in order to be saved and forgiven. Once he saved me, he cleansed me. John 15 and 13 let me know that I'm clean through the word. His word taught me that it's only through him that I can be saved. His word also taught me through Acts 4 and 12 that neither is there any salvation under in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Nobody can save us but Jesus. We can't depend on anyone else. Not Buddha, not Muhammad, not Allah, not Krishna, not nobody. It's only through Jesus and his blood that we are saved. God is God and he don't need no help. His words taught me that I don't have to continue in sin. Romans 6 and 1 through 2. And also his word taught me that I don't have to live in bondage. Amen. Now I can say I am no longer living in bondage, but I'm free. I'm free from sin, and I'm free from guilt, and I'm free from shame.
All right, man.
Well, praise the Lord. And that's what her salvation means to her. Didn't she do an awesome job on tonight? Hallelujah. Amen. Put those hands together for our pastor on tonight. Hallelujah. We thank God for the man of God. Hallelujah. We're moving right along on tonight. It's time to praise God in our giving. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
The body of Christ. Amen. To change the hearts and the minds of people. Y'all can get quiet. Amen. The devil, did you know the devil will send people to church? Amen. The devil ain't got real people, but he'll send the counterfeits into the body of Christ. And that's the reason why, amen, you've got to be careful about who you yoke up with, even in the house of God. Amen. Everybody that's shouting and speaking in some kind of tongue ain't got the Holy Ghost. You still got folk that the devil has sent in to be a negative example, amen, before the eyes of those young ones that are coming seeking a better life and a different walk. Amen. But you've got to be careful, and you've got to know that that's not God. That's why we've got to preach to you the word. Amen. Because the word of God is a lamp and a light. Amen. It's going to shine on all of those motives that other people are trying to hide. And I don't care how good they talk. What you got to learn how to do, amen, is measure their conduct by the word of God. Oh, Lord, everybody that's speaking in tongues and trying to prophesy to you, amen, ain't doing so by the Spirit of God. The Bible says you try the Spirit, y'all. I'm trying to figure out if I got somebody here that know the word. Amen. And he says, you've got to try the spirit. I don't care, amen, if they look like they saved, try that spirit. Look, Yahweh said, if they prophesy, you ain't got to just submit to every word that folk trying to speak over your life. You try that spirit. And how do you try the spirit? Huh? By the word of God. Oh God, somebody said, you try the spirit by the spirit. No, you try the spirit by the word of God. Because the word of God is already settled in the heaven. Isn't that what the scripture tells us? Amen. Psalms 119 and 89 says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. If you don't like it, you can't do nothing with the word. Amen. The apostle used to tell us, you got to go to heaven to change this word. And by the time you get there, changing it ain't going to be on your mind. Amen. So we try the spirit by the word of God. So what does that tell us? That tells us we got to know this word, don't it? Amen. You got to know what it says for yourself. And that's why I feel bad for people. Amen. That say, I can't go to church because I know this about people. And I've seen people do that. They don't know the word. Because if they knew the word, they would realize the Bible never said, amen, measure your life by people. He said, Christ left us an example. Look at somebody and tell them, Christ is my example. I ain't worried about who lying. I ain't worried about who cheating. Amen. I ain't leaving the church because of shit.
Oh, who opens doors that I cannot see? Jesus will. Jesus will. Oh, and who will make all my decisions for me? Jesus will. Jesus will. Who opens doors, say?
Who opens doors
that I cannot see? Jesus.
Jesus will.
Jesus will.
Jesus will.
And who will make all my decisions?
Who will make all
for me? Jesus.
Jesus will.
Yes, he will.
Jesus will.
I say, when I'm in trouble,
when I'm in trouble,
he gives
me a song.
I say, when I'm in trouble,
when I'm in trouble,
he gives me a song. Everybody say, oh yes,
oh yes,
Jesus will,
Jesus will,
I know he will because he said he will,
oh yes,
Jesus will,
Jesus will,
I know he will,
I know he will,
he said he will,
he said he will,
he'll fight my battle,
he'll fight my battle,
if I keep still,
if I keep
I keep still.
I know that
Jesus will.
Jesus will.
I know he will because he said he will.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus will.
Jesus will.
I know he will.
I know he will.
He said he will.
He said he will.
He'll fight your battle.
He'll fight my battle.
If I keep still.
If I keep still.
If I keep still.
If you love the Lord, put your hands together and give him some praise, everybody. Oh, I said put your hands together and give him praise. That means you got to say something to the Lord. Come on. If you love him, open your mouth and give him praise. With the fruit of your lips, all that men would praise him. Hallelujah. For the Lord's been good. Has he been good to anybody? Then come on and give him the best you can give him right now. Come on. Hallelujah. And we bless him tonight. Certainly, let's thank God for that wonderful testimony that we heard. Amen. God is a keeper. Let's thank God for Sister Anika. Amen. Certainly we enjoyed her tonight. Amen. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And I tell you, God has been so faithful and so kind to us. God bless you. Take your seat in the presence of the Lord. What a fellowship. Amen. What a joy divine. I'm grateful to be here. Amen. Glad that God has brought us together one more time. He's so mindful of us. Amen. So exceptionally kind towards us. He's brought us together. Amen. In the house of the Lord. And we come to hear what God is saying in this hour. Amen. God has been so good to us all day long. I tell you, it's just a blessing to be here tonight. Hey, y'all hear what I said? I said, it's a blessing to be here tonight. Amen. I told you a while back, I'd rather be here than the hospital. Amen. It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I'd rather be here than in jail. Amen. As a matter of fact, there's no other place I would rather be than right where I am. I'm telling you, church, amen, the word of God, the fellowship of the believers, those things still excite me. Amen. I get joy out of serving the Lord. Thank God for being here on another Thursday night. Amen. I tell you, we had some wonderful church here Sunday night. If you were not here, amen, you missed it. Thank God. Seems like every time we come together, God is blessing us, pouring out his favor on us. Amen. And I believe tonight is going to be no exception. Amen. We had a wonderful time Tuesday night. Amen. At headquarters, I've been teaching, amen, for the past 3 weeks about now that I'm saved, what do I do? Amen. A lot of people need to know that. Amen. It's more to this than just starting the journey. A lot of people start. Amen. And they think the start is the total journey. No, that's simply the beginning. Amen. Now that I'm saved, what is it that God expects out of me? As a matter of fact, amen, what is it that I can do? Amen. For the service of the kingdom of our God. Amen. Because it's not just about, amen, what it is that you don't do anymore. You know, some people make holiness, amen, and salvation about the stuff that we don't do anymore. Amen. No, the Bible says, but depart from evil. That's the stuff you don't do. But then he says, now do good. Amen. Now, it's more to this than just the stuff we don't do anymore. Amen. There are things that he requires of us to do. And we've got to learn all of that, amen, so that we can be the productive children of God that he's calling for us to be in this hour. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, there's a word from the Lord. And tell them, and I am a lover of the word of God. Amen. I brought mine. You got yours? Come on, hold that power up. Thank God. Hallelujah. Because everything else is going down. But what? Now, I keep asking you. You believe that, don't you? If you don't, just look. Amen. If you read the front of the paper, amen, watch the leading story on the news every night, amen, you'll find out that the systems of this world are crumbling and caving in. Everything else is going down but the word of our God. That's why I want you to, amen, to fall in love with this. Y'all still reading, aren't you? Amen. We're still in our scripture challenge, our panoramic, amen, reading challenge for the month of September. We're more than halfway there now. Hey, look at some of y'all. Y'all quit already? All right. Amen. We got to keep reading. I really want you to get used to the language of scripture too. Amen. Because, you know, I was in counseling the other day in session, and a young lady asked me, she said, what books do I need? What? And I told her, you know, books are okay. Amen. Those commentaries, they're okay. But, you know, as many, and she asked me, she said, well, what kind of books do you read? And I've had a program for the last 22 years or so. Amen. And I looked at my program. I literally have 13,500 books that I have collected over the course of about 22 years now. And I told her, but you know, out of all the books that I have, there's not one that you'll agree 100% with. You know, so don't get stuck on that. Amen. Because, you know, commentaries, and I appreciate people, God have given them great wisdom. Amen. But now there's not one that I just agree 100% with. And so I told her, the one thing you need to know, amen, you need to be familiar with more than anything else
is the word of God. Don't ever read anything more than you read this right here. Are y'all hearing what I'm trying to tell you? Amen. Don't ever read anything more than you read this. Amen. Y'all can get quiet when y'all want to. Amen. When you get used to the language of Scripture, amen, then it's not hard for you to interpret the Scripture with the Scripture. Amen. But a lot of times I'm finding that people now are comparing the Bible to the stuff they read in a commentary. And you never compare the Bible to something you read. You always compare what you read to the Scripture. Amen. So I want you to get used to the language of the Scripture. Amen. Amen. Get used to hearing God speak, amen, in the terms that he does. Because that's going to benefit you in your study of the word of God. I don't want you to get twisted up with a bunch of other stuff. Amen. That's the reason why. Amen. And we have this challenge going now. Amen. We ain't drinking water and walking crates and eating chips and all them other challenges that people do now. Amen. We're in the Scripture. I want you to know the word of God. Because if you can be familiar with the word of God, you know what I found out? I'll get to the sermon in a minute. But you know what I found out? I found out it's not hard to recognize the voice of God. You have a lot of people who are, well, I want to know, how do I know when God is speaking? Because his voice sounds just like his word. And if you don't know his word, it's hard for you to distinguish his voice. Amen. I tell them all the time, if I write you a letter every day, and I probably won't. You know, but if I did, you know, at some point you would just get used to the phrases that I use. Amen. Amen. You would get used to hearing me use certain words. And if I were talking behind you in a grocery store and I use some of those phrases and them words, then you probably turn around and say, man, that sounds like him. And that's how it is when it comes to reading the word of God. Amen. If you want to know the voice of God, you can't know the voice of God unless you're familiar with the word. It's easy for people to get tricked. When they don't know the word of God, amen, they'll think that God told them to do this. And anybody that's real seasoned in the word will tell you that ain't God. That ain't, I don't care what you heard, how good you feel. That ain't God. Because this right here, this is what we live by. Amen. We can live by whatever God has said. The book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. And I want to begin reading at the 5th through the 11th verses. That's Hebrews 12. Amen. Hebrews chapter number 12, verses 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. Can I talk to y'all tonight? All right, I'll do that. Amen. Hebrews chapter number 12, beginning verse number 5. And when you have it, say amen. Read what the Bible says. And ye have forgotten
the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children.
Which speaketh unto you as unto children. Now we're familiar with the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews. We're just familiar with the first four verses. Amen. You know, seeing as how we are compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us, you know, run with patience the race set before us, lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us. Amen. And remember him that endured such contradiction of sinners, you know, lest ye be weary and faint in your mind, and for ye have not resisted unto blood. And now he comes in and he says, but it seems like you have forgotten the exhortation that was spoken unto you as unto children.
My son.
My son.
Despise not thou the chastening of the Lord.
Despise not thou the chastening of the Lord.
Nor faint when thou art rebuked of him.
Boy, y'all getting quiet already. He said, I don't want you to faint when he rebukes you. Now notice He didn't say if. He didn't say if. I don't want you to faint when you get rebuked by him. Oh, God, look at somebody and tell them it's bound to happen. It's just, how you going to make it out of this life? It's bound to happen. Come on, and we're going to see why. Read.
For whom the Lord loveth.
Because if he loves you,
he chasteneth.
He's going to chasten you.
And scourgeth every son.
And God is going to scourge. He scourgeth every son.
Whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening.
If ye endure chastening.
God dealeth with you as with sons.
He deals with you as with sons. So it's not so bad. Amen. Because, amen, if you endure the chastening of God, he deals with you like he would a son. That's a good thing, isn't it? Amen. Amen. Read.
For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not?
I'm trying to figure it out. What son is it that a father has that he's not going to chasten if he loves him? If he loves him. Read.
But if ye be without chastisement.
If you be without chastisement.
Whereof all are partakers.
Whereof all of us are partakers.
Then are ye bastards. And not sons.
Then the Bible said, you're not a son, you're a bastard. Boy, y'all getting quiet here. Read what the scripture says.
Furthermore. We have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us. And we gave them reverence.
We gave them reverence.
Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits?
Our spiritual father?
And live.
And live. Boy, ain't that something? He corrects us and we can give reverence to him and we live. Amen. Live. The correction of God, amen, will cause us to live. We got to submit ourselves unto our spiritual father and live. Read.
For they verily, for a few days, chasten us after their own pleasure.
After their own pleasure.
But he is for our profit.
But when he does it for our profit.
That ye might be partakers of his holiness.
Lord, look at that. That ye might be partakers of his holiness. Thank you, Lord. Read.
Now, no chastening for the present seemed to be joyous.
Listen to this. No chastening in the present seems to be joyous. You know, that's the reason why you cry when you get a whooping. You. I don't know nobody sitting there. Oh, no. By the time you get to that whooping dance. It's not pleasurable in that moment. Read.
But grievous.
Nevertheless.
Afterward. It yielded the peaceable fruit of righteousness.
Of righteousness.
Unto them which are exercised thereby.
My. Did y'all hear what the writer of the Hebrews has just told us? He gave us clarity just in case somebody didn't understand why God does the things that he does. He gives us clarity right here. He says, you have forgotten the exhortation, amen, that was spoken unto you as unto children. What did he say? My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord. That's what I want to talk to you about tonight. Somebody say the chastening of the Lord. Yeah, now and then we got to talk about this stuff. We got to have some difficult conversations. Amen. You've got to realize, first of all, and I love to tell people, amen, as a foundation to where we're going, that God loves us. You believe that tonight? Are we the children of his pleasure? You believe God loves us tonight? Amen. He absolutely loves us. The Bible tells us that he does. Amen. The Bible even says that he didn't start loving us when we got saved. For God so loved the world. The world means the unregenerated, those that don't know him, those that are outside of the parameters of the will of God. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Hear this, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. But now that we are the children of God, God has taken his love for us to an entirely new level. Amen. He absolutely loves, amen, the children of God. And he expresses his love to us very differently, amen, than those who are not of the family of God. Amen. You've got people that still don't understand the love of God. Amen. But I want you to know that tonight, as a foundation, don't ever forget that God loves you, because it matters how you see God. It matters the light through which you interpret his action. Because if you ever take the love of God off of the table, then the only thing that you can relate or respond to, amen, is somebody. And you're turning to somebody that believes that God is hateful, that God is vengeful, that God is wrathful, amen, and that God is somebody that you ought to be scared of. Amen. Now, that's not what the Bible means when he talks about the fear of the Lord. Amen. The fear of the Lord is a healthy reverence, amen, for the God of the universe. Amen. But what did the Bible tells us? Amen. That our minds, once we come to know God, cannot just be focused on the punishment. Amen. No, because that causes people to become afraid. Amen. They're fearful. Amen. And we know the scripture tells us, and that's what it means when he says that perfect love casts out fear. Amen. Now that we have become the children of God, can I talk to you? Now that we are the children of God, God deals with us very differently. He expresses his love and his concern, amen, for us in various ways. Now those ways go far beyond, amen, how people think God ought to express the love that he has for us. People think that all God is supposed to do now, amen, is feed us and clothe us and, amen, answer our tantrums and, amen, just give us everything that we need, amen, guarantee us a life of ease and pleasure and prosperity, as if there, that is all that there is to God. But can I tell you, he is our Father. Now, and as our Father, amen, there are so many other responsibilities that God has beyond just supplying our wants and catering to our tantrums. Do you know, amen, according to the word of God, amen, a good father is supposed to protect. He is, amen, y'all getting quiet here. He's supposed to provide for his children. But not only is a father, amen, to protect and provide, amen, but a father is also there to correct. Amen. The Bible talks about training a child in the way that they should go. And how is it that we train a child? Amen. It is through what we call discipline. Are y'all with me tonight? Amen. So in order for us to properly train a child, there has to be discipline. Amen. It has to go beyond just giving them everything that they want. We can't just give them, amen, all of the niceties of life. Amen. Because if you give them everything, but you never discipline or correct their behavior, then they'll grow up and they'll be spoiled. Amen. They'll think that the world owes them something. Y'all, look at y'all getting quiet. They'll think, amen, that that's all people are good for. Amen. It's to give them everything that they want. And don't you know it's the same when it comes to God? Amen. If God just simply gave us everything that we wanted, amen, if he always did everything that we asked him to do, amen, without regard to how we live and the things that we, amen, engage in, so many of us would start to take God for granted. We would believe that that's all he exists for, amen, is to cater to our needs and our desires, amen. But according to the word of God, chastening is one of the most important and fruitful responsibilities that a father has, amen. And let me tell you tonight, our heavenly Father knows how to do it right. Are y'all hearing what I'm telling you? Amen. I said our heavenly Father knows how to do it right. You know what I found out? Amen. That there is no honor in being the father of a child or children who live without a certain level of training.
restraining and decorum. Amen. You see it all the time. At least I do. Amen. And I hope you do too. Amen. Because you see it. Amen. In grocery stores. I remember years ago, I worked at Tom Thumb number 563. Amen. In Duncanville, Texas. Amen. And while I was there, I remember, amen, as a cashier, a little boy came up. Amen. And he was talking to his mother. Young guy. Amen. Couldn't have been no older than early teens. And amen. He was talking to his mother and she didn't do what he asked her to do. Amen. And he started throwing a tantrum right there. Amen. At the register. I'm sitting there looking. Amen. Because I know, amen, that had that been me, y'all getting quiet here, there would have been some consequences and some repercussions. Amen. And she just said no. And he started throwing this tantrum, Elder, and come to find out, he wanted her to buy him some cigarettes. Look at y'all done got quiet here. A little boy wanted, when she wouldn't get it for him, he just went off on her right there. Amen. In the store. I'm telling you, amen, it does not do a parent good, amen, to be the parent of a child that doesn't have a level of training and decorum. Look at y'all, he said, and now I wish his mama had been like my mama, because my mama told me wherever you show out is where I'm going to get you. Hey, you, Lord, y'all done got quiet. You can fall out if you want to. She always told us, I'm going to fall out with you. Amen. And only one of us going to walk straight when we get up. Lord, look at the church ain't saying nothing. I remember my mom used to threaten us, and she said, I'm going to whip you, and if you call the police, you just got to know you're going to have to call them twice, because when I get back, I'm going to whip you all over again. Amen. Oh, it don't do you any good not to have children in subjection. Amen. And listen, let me say this. If you got to do all that and show out with them, well, get up, Johnny. Amen. Don't do that, Johnny. Don't make me. Listen, you done already lost that battle. Amen. Because the fact that he'll show out like that in the first place means that you haven't gotten him to the point that he needs to be in discipline. Can I tell you, amen, a disciplined child wouldn't try nothing like that in public. They too scared of being embarrassed. You know what Proverbs 17 and 21 says? Somebody needs to get in and look at it. Proverbs 17 and 21. Oh, Lord. Look at the wise man talking to us here. He that begetteth a fool has sorrow. Did y'all hear? Nah, I didn't call nobody a fool. The Bible called him a fool. Amen. And the Bible says that he that begetteth a fool has sorrow. Now, I don't know no parent that just won't acknowledge the fact that they child a fool. I ain't never, hey, where's little Johnny? Oh, that fool over there somewhere. You don't hear that kind of stuff. Huh? And let me say this. God don't want his children. Boy, now I got too far to go for y'all to be sitting up here looking at me. Hey, God don't want his children acting any kind of way, living in any kind of manner, especially that which does not speak to the greatness of your Father. You've got to know God expects something out of you. You are a child of God, and you ought to represent him better than that. No, we're the children of, look at somebody and tell them we are the children of God. Amen. We've got to be reminded of that, that God don't want us looking any kind of way. He don't want us behaving any kind of way. Amen. Especially not according to the standards by which we have been called to live. Amen. That's the reason the Bible says in 2 Timothy, what is that, 2:19? Amen. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal that the Lord knows them that belong to him. And let everyone that names the name of God, let him do what? Let him depart from iniquity. If you are a child of God, amen, God expects a certain behavior out of you. I don't don't care how quiet y'all get tonight. I'm telling you, God is looking at how you live. He's looking at your behavior. He's looking at your actions. He's looking at your motivations. He is looking at your character. When your behavior and your character don't reflect who he is, God's got a problem with that. Amen. And you've got to know, amen, that he is a father that will correct our bad behavior. Yeah, he will. Some of y'all looking, amen, and I'm looking back at you. You've got to know that God wants your character right. You walking around talking about you're a child of God. Amen. The Bible said there's a standard that goes along with that. And when our lives, our behaviors, our actions, and our characters are not in line or in sync with the will of God, God's got to correct that behavior in us. And he does it because he loves us.
Now, I think it's worth noting that God don't just throw us in the trash. That God loves us enough that he don't just get rid of us, because you know he could now. Amen. God could just start all over again and, amen, just get rid. He kept telling Moses, Moses, get back. Let me kill them all. Amen. Let me wipe all of them out and I'll start a new nation. I'll raise up another nation. And Moses said, no, Lord, you don't do that. Because if you do that, God, you've got people, amen, that are going to declare that the reason you killed them was that you brought them out, but you couldn't take them all the way in. Amen. They're going to talk bad about that. Amen. God said, I'll do it. And he could do that today. He could wipe all of us out and just start over. But God loves you enough to Lord, y'all done got quiet. Look at somebody and tell him he found something in me he could use. Amen. I don't know why he keep us around. Amen. But he obviously sees something in us.
And we've got to understand why he's the kind of father that he is. You know what I found out? I found out that for us to misunderstand God's actions in our development is to cause us to run away from him rather than enduring the process that is making us more like him. If we don't see this the right way, then when he starts to tighten up on us, oh God, a lot of people run away from him rather than enduring the process that's going to make us more like him. Hey, can I tell you, he's not trying to kill you. Are y'all hearing me tonight? I said God is not trying to kill you. Amen. God is trying to mold you and make you, amen, a better child of God. And you know what he does? And I love this now. Amen. God never leaves us to raise ourselves.
He's not going to leave us to raise ourselves. And that's the good part. Because some of us wouldn't be all that we could be if he left us to our own devices. No, God has to lead us. He has to guide us. Amen. He has to correct us. He has to train us to be the people he's calling us to be. And so now, look at what he does. He encourages our good behavior. Yeah, if you be willing and obedient, then you'll eat the good of the land.
Well, I was reading today in Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter. I'm telling you, boy, them first 14 verses are something else. He starts talking about, if you'll listen and obey my ways and, amen, hearken unto my words, I'll bless you in the city. I'll bless you in the field. I'll bless you going out. I'll bless you coming in. I'll bless the work of your hands. I'll bless the fruit of your body. Y'all done got quiet. I'm telling you, he encourages the good behavior. But then he also, if he's going to train us properly, he's got to discourage that bad behavior. Huh? And as he is discouraging the bad behavior, amen, he's got to chasten us to teach us not to do that again.
And this is where a lot of us are tonight. We didn't realize that's what was going on. And we're here despising the process and asking, Lord, why and how long. And I don't understand what's going on. Can I tell you, amen, some of us tonight, we're just enduring the chastening of the Lord. But I don't want you to get discouraged, because he's doing it based on the fact that he loves you. He could have balled you up like a sheet of paper and thrown you in the trash. But the fact that he let you hang around and said, I just, they'll be okay. I just got to teach them not to do that again. I got to teach them not to go there again. They're going to be fine. They just got some learning to do. And I've told you before, amen, one of my business partners always says, amen, the unlearned are simply the untaught. Amen. And God knows that some of us, amen, we're doing stuff not because we're malicious in our intentions. Sometimes we just didn't know no better. But it don't change the fact that you still did it. So what God's got to do, he's got to teach us, amen, how to, oh God, amen, to walk with him. And listen, his chastening carries two definitions. And I want you to write this down. First of all, it is to teach, to train, or to instruct a person. That's what chastening is. It is to teach or to train or to instruct a person. And then secondly, it is to discipline or to correct. Did y'all hear that? First of all, it's to teach, train, or instruct a person. Secondly, it is to discipline or to correct that individual. And God will use both of these in the process of bringing us into conformity with his will. Amen. He'll train us, he'll teach us, and that's wonderful. Amen. But he also has to discipline us. He has to correct us. As a matter of fact, amen, chastening works for our benefit, so we really should embrace the idea of it.
Boy, look at him. You can't hardly get church folk now to embrace that idea. You've got to learn to embrace the idea of correction and discipline. You got to expect that that's what God's going to do. And listen, like I told you the other night, and you got to be okay with that. You got to be okay with the idea that if God sees you going the wrong direction, he's going to straighten that out.
But if you really want to go all the way with God, you ought to appreciate the fact, amen, that God sometimes got to whoop our hind parts, amen, just to get us back into the place that he wanted us to be. So it really works for us. You know what I want you to do? Get me Proverbs 3:11-12.
Y'all didn't close your Bibles, did you? Proverbs, the third chapter. The 11th and the 12th verse.
Mm-hmm. My son.
My son. Now listen. And this is who he's talking to. He's talking to his children. My son.
Despise not the chastening of the Lord.
No, God ain't fair. It's too hard. Why would God do that to me? I don't understand. It wasn't even that bad what I did.
You can't despise the chastening of the Lord. Can I tell you something? Amen. God knows what it takes to get you into the place he wanted you to be. Amen. And listen, can I say this? You ain't got to worry about nobody else. God knows how to deal with you.
I remember growing up, I think there was one year, I think I got a whooping just about every day in that year. Oh, yeah, I was something else. Don't tell nobody that. I don't want nobody to have a bad understanding of me. I was so bad, I remember I got a whooping on my birthday. I'm telling you, it was something else. I'm telling you, I was a rough customer. Praise the Lord. Amen. Sometime all of us be lined up in the hallway. Y'all don't know nothing about them lineups? Y'all know about the lineups, eh? Everybody gonna get that. We all in the hallway, and PJ going first, and hearing that jumping, and I'm out there laughing and crying at the same time. And Brother Colby's wife, my sister Joy never had to get it like the rest of us. They could talk to Joy, and Joy would just cry. Joy, you shouldn't have done it. I'm sorry. And that's all the punishment she needs. She changed, her whole life changed after that. No problem. The rest of us, we was in that line.
And sometimes Joy would be back there. We'd be up there doing a dance, you know, when they hit you. And Joy would be over in the corner laughing. And we all be over there licking our wounds after it's over, and Joy would be sitting there playing with dolls and all that stuff. But that's what it took for me. Oh, ain't nobody going to talk to me. I mean, a talk wasn't going to do nothing for me. I'm telling you, I've always been that kind of person. A conversation? Oh, no, you got to come harder than that. Amen, amen. You have to bring the thunder because I ain't that kind. Amen, amen. And so I understood that it takes different levels for different people. That's why you ain't got no business looking around trying to figure stuff out. When he's chastening you, it's because he knows what it's going to take to get you to the kingdom of heaven. And that's the reason I don't worry about what other folk doing in other churches. No, God know what to send me because he knows what it's going to take to get me there. I'm not comparing myself to nobody else. Look at somebody and tell them, just worry about you. That's all. Amen. Just worry about you. Amen. He had to take you and chasten you. It ain't got nothing to do with everybody else, because if they don't make it in, you got to make sure you do. So, Lord, whatever you got to do to get me there. No. Proverbs. Did you get it? Come on. My son.
Despise not the chastening of the Lord.
Despise not the chastening of the Lord.
Neither be weary of his correction.
Hear this. Don't get tired of God correcting you. You can't get tired of God, because what God is doing, hear this word now, and people run away from it. He is perfecting you. And in the perfecting process, he has to get everything that ain't right. And sometimes you come to church and it seems like God ain't doing nothing but talking straight to you. He whooped you Sunday. He gonna whoop you Tuesday. He gonna whoop you Thursday. Y'all getting quiet here. But you can't get weary with his correction. I can't believe it. I went to church and Hunter, the preacher, it looked like he was preaching right to me. He was. Telling you now, that's exactly who I was preaching to. But you ought to thank God that God decided to waste the whole sermon just to get you right. Don't be weary with his correction. Read.
For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth.
It is a sign of love that God is willing to correct you. Read.
Even as a father, the son in whom he delighted.
And a father would do the same thing for a son in whom he delighted. If he want him to go far in life, he's going to have to correct that wrong early. He's going to have to teach him respect for authority. Y'all getting quiet here. He's going to have to tell him, you don't call me by my first name. You say yes, sir, to me. Amen. You're going to respect me. Why? Because he don't want him to get out of his house, amen, and go out there and somebody who don't love him, amen, going to treat him bad. And so what he has to do, if he really loves him, he's got to give him what he needs to be successful in life. And I'm telling you now, in order for God to give you what you need, in order to be successful in this walk, he's got to correct that bad behavior. Boy, y'all getting quiet about this correction stuff. Because some things you got to realize, it may not be nothing big to you, but it's a seed that's been sown in your spirit. And if God don't root that seed up out of you, it's going to grow into something you can't control. See, it's the small foxes that do what? That destroy the vine. Why do they get a chance to destroy the vine? Because you think it's harmless. You think that's a puppy. That's not a puppy. That's a fox. Y'all get quiet here. And you can't overlook nothing. And just in case you do, God said, I'm not. I'm going to get it. Because I'm perfecting you. And in the perfecting process, he can't let no blemishes. No, escape his gaze. He can't allow any imperfections to remain there. So that means God's going to put his finger on everything that ain't right. it's because he loved. Y'all want me to shut up? Is that why y'all looking like that? All right, well, fix your face, because I was confused there for a moment. Job, chapter number 5, verse 17 and 18. Y'all write these down. I want y'all to see this. Job, chapter number 5, verse 17 and 18.
Behold, happy is the man whom God corrected.
Now, wait a minute. Then why did I leave church crying that night? Y'all ain't never left church and, well, I know y'all have. I have too. You ain't never left church and went home and had to sit there and think about it. Get home, try to figure out now what just happened to me. Lord, I've been there. I told you, Pastor Murray used to walk up one side of me and down the other. I used to go home, sit on the side of the bathtub, and just sit there and think about it. What was that about? But the Bible says, happy is the man whom God corrected. Read.
Therefore, despise not thou the chastening of the Almighty.
Did you hear this? Don't run from that. I ain't going back to church no more. Don't you run from that. Boy, y'all getting quiet now. I can't believe he preached that. I can't believe he said that. Don't you go nowhere. Don't you despise the correction of the Almighty. Did you hear that? He's almighty. He could have killed you, but instead he corrected you. Don't that tell you something about how he feel about you? Don't run away from that. Don't you leave church. Don't you backslide because you have to be corrected. How can you grow? Can I tell you something? If a parent never corrected a child, that child wouldn't live long. He wouldn't live long. Don't play with those scissors. Don't put that in your mouth. Don't touch that stove. Don't run out there in them streets. Look at y'all ain't saying nothing. Y'all done got a child that is not corrected is a child that won't live long. He has to learn the right way. And y'all getting quiet here. He's got to know what to do and what not to do. And that's what God is doing for us. We didn't come here because we knew everything. We are still, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. We got some learning to do. And part of that learning process is the fact that God's got to correct us when we've done wrong. Boy, I feel like y'all want me to hurry up and be quiet. Read.
For he make it sore.
Listen to what it says. He make it sore.
And bind it up.
Oh. He makes sore and he what?
Bind it up.
Huh? Read.
He wounded.
He won't. Sometimes God got it. Lord, they don't want to hear this. I'm trying to find somebody to preach to tonight because the rest of them don't want to hear this. Anybody know that God don't mind wounding you? Sometimes God got to break you all the way down. Lord, they're getting quiet on Thursday night. Sometimes God, amen, knows that he can't just sit up, amen, and allow you to keep going in that direction. And after he kept saying no and, amen, telling you no, you wouldn't hear that. So sometimes God literally has to break you. To correct you. He wounds and what?
And his hands make whole.
Did you hear that? He will make you sore. And then he will bind you up. Look at somebody and tell him it hurts, but it's going to heal.
It hurts, but it's going to heal. Don't worry about that. He's got to wound us sometimes. But the same hand that broke us is the same hand that's going to make us whole. You know, I've seen children born, amen, with limbs that were, amen, that were crooked. Legs and arms that were crooked. And you know what the doctor had to do?
Look at y'all. Ain't saying nothing here.
They went to the doctor, to the surgeon, and you know what they were expecting him to do? And he did it. He had to break their leg.
Boy, y'all done got quiet here.
That's what a doctor's got to do. Amen. If you can't, if your leg is crooked, amen, and it hinders you, amen, from walking right, then what the doctor's got to do, he's got to break that leg. But you know what he does after he breaks it? He sets it so that this time when it grows straight. And you look at somebody and tell them you can walk right now. Sometimes God's got to break you so you can walk right after he heals you.
Well, let me hurry. I hate to have to turn this into a series. I want to finish this tonight.
So we see the writer of the Hebrews quoting the book of Proverbs saying that God is going to chasten everybody that he loves.
Lord, I ain't going to get done with this. I got another whole page.
He chastens, hear this, he chastens everybody that he loves. That means nobody escapes the correction of the Lord. They don't believe that. I can tell by the way you're looking. Y'all don't believe that. Nobody escapes the correction of the Lord. Can I tell you, the preacher, don't escape the correct. Look at that. I told you they didn't believe that. I told them last night that God will whoop you while you're preaching. Take your voice while you wagging your finger in front of everybody. And God just whooping you. Come on out of that TV. Hey, get on your knees. And you know, you ain't read enough. You need to pray more. And you sit up and tell, you need to pray more. And God said, I hope you hear what I'm talking to you. I hope you get it. Hey, man, God will whoop you while you talk.
Well, they don't believe that.
I remember hearing a woman preach years ago. And she said she was calling herself a prophetess. And somebody messed around and told her she looked like Toni Braxton. So she says she went to the beautician and she told her, cut my hair like Toni Braxton. And so they cut her hair and she says she's walking through the mall with them tight blue jeans on. She says she came to church that night and she heard God whisper in her ear and said, you call yourself a prophetess? All right, let's prophesy. And she said she was standing at the altar with her hair cut and all that. And she was yelling out, stop cutting your hair! Stood her right up in front of the whole congregation. And here she is down there. And God whooping her in front of everybody. Stop cutting your hair! She said she's just down there crying. And he just kept, you a prophetess? Let's prophesy. You can't be a hot, sexy prophetess. Dress holy. Look holy. Stop cutting your hair! When I tell you nobody escapes the correction of the Lord, I mean nobody. Because if God loves us, God is going to correct us. Let me hasten. I got to close. The reason why, hear this, is because he's our Father. That's a relationship that carries a responsibility with it. You got a responsibility. All this cheering we got around here. We got responsibility. The relationship brings with it a responsibility. And he is responsible to correct, because if he don't, who will? If he don't correct us first,
then who will? He's got to teach us his way, because there's a way that seems right to me. Some of this stuff we just love to do, we would never stop and we would never correct ourselves. We would make excuses to do it because it feels good, it looks good. But because he's our father, he has to correct our wrong behavior. And a father that truly loves his children is not trying to be their friend. Huh? What he's interested in is seeing them develop properly and develop to become who he knows they have the capacity to be. God's not trying to be our friend. He's trying to develop us. Yeah. And in the process of developing us, he's got to hurt us sometimes. Oh, but it's how you see it. Amen. You have to see it properly. Because if the devil can get you to see the correction of God wrongly, then he's going to run you from God. It matters how you see it. And I want you to hear this. God poured his wrath on Jesus when Jesus died. Oh, yeah. The Bible said it pleased God to bruise him. Oh, Lord. It pleased God to bruise him. The wages of sin is death. And when Jesus died, he died for the sins of the whole world. And that don't mean for every sinner. That means for every sin that every sinner would ever commit. Boy, y'all getting quiet here. Amen. And if we had all together collectively sinned 3 trillion times, then he had to die death for every sin. Amen. How many sins does it take in order for a man to die? The wages of sin, not sins, the wages of sin is death. So that means if you committed 30,000 sins in your life, he died 30,000 deaths just for you. And God poured his wrath out on Jesus Christ. Look at him. He went through the nails. He went through the crown of thorns. He went through the reed. The Bible said they would pull his beard out. He endured all of that and never said a word. They beat him over his back, pulling chunks of skin out. He's bleeding all over the place. He never said a word. But when God turned his back on him and poured out that wrath for the first time in the process, you hear Jesus talking. That was too much for him to bear. Oh, that wasn't no ordinary death. That was the wrath of God. The punishment for sin being poured out on our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. And he was there in our place. He was wounded. Our transgressions, bruised, our iniquities, chastisement of our peace was upon him. Now, for the believer, God expresses no wrath towards us. Are y'all hearing me? I'm done. I won't finish it tonight. But for the believer, he does not have to express his wrath towards us. Jesus took our place. And the wrath that should have been ours was laid upon him. And so now all we've got to do is come to him in a saving way. And now for the believer, Lord help, the wrath that should have been ours is no longer expressed towards us. Remember, you remember, we talked about it, what was that last week? The Bible says that Jesus, amen, delivered us from the wrath to come. Y'all remember that? He delivered us, so now wrath is no longer our portion. So once we believe God for salvation, now he doesn't pour wrath on us. Jesus took the wrath, paid the penalty for our sins, and now everything that God expresses towards the believer is done out of love. And so it matters how you see the correction of God. Because sometimes the devil will tell you God is doing that because he hates you. But you've got to rise in that moment and say, but I'm a believer. And for the believer, the wrath of God only comes upon the children of disobedience. Oh, God, y'all done got quiet here. Amen, but I'm a believer. And so that means that he doesn't express wrath to me. Everything that he expresses is an expression of love. So what God does to me is not just what we would call punitive. It's not punishment. It's corrective. Boy, y'all getting quiet here. I remember we were in another country, and me and Chad had a chance to go, and they took us on a tour of the prison system. And I mean, you talk about this place, I'm telling you, you don't want to go there. You don't want to go there. The jail cell was not even as long as this pew. And I think it was about 6 feet wide. And there was about 6 to 8 men in that cell. They were laying all on each other's legs. Didn't have space to stretch. You couldn't do it. There was too many people in there for that. They had one bucket. Y'all getting quiet. No plumbing. The bucket sat over in the corner. Everybody used the same bucket. They only emptied it at about 6:30 in the morning. And so they told us if the prisoners get into a fight and knock that bucket over, then it just stays there until 6:30 the next morning. There was no lights in the cell. No vents in the cell. The only circulation they had was one of them big fans, them tall fans, that sat at the end of the corridor. And it just blew, and whatever air got into the cell just got in. But with 6 to 8 men in there, how much air can you get in that? And the hallway wasn't no wider than this. And we walking down and hands and legs were sticking through the bars. And I'm walking like I ain't scared. I was terrified. But they explained to us. They said the thing is people get out of this prison and they come back. They said because when they get out, they're so angry. They go and find the people that put them there, and chances are a lot of times they're going to do something to them, and they're going to end up right back in there. And they said the United Nations has declared that prison is inhumane. Because what they say is that it's not about rehabilitation, it is strictly about punishment. They're not trying to change behavior. They just want to punish you and punish you and punish you and don't care if you're a different person when you get out. That's all. So there are no classes in there to educate you. There's no therapy in there to ask you what's going on. Why are you so angry? What are you doing? No, they just make it as hard as they can make it on you because all they are interested in is punishing you. They're not trying to make you better. And that's how the devil wants you to see God. As if every time God has a different understanding of your actions than you had when you committed it. I don't know why God is punishing me. I don't know why God's so angry with me. And you know what? Stop saying stuff like that. What did I do to make him so angry? What did I do to make him mad at me? And the devil always telling church folk, God must be mad at you. Stop letting the devil tell you that he's mad at you. He's not angry with you. This is not about punishment. This is about correction. And the difference between the two, boy, y'all getting quiet, is the motivation of the person behind the action. Some folk don't want you to be better. But then you got other folk that are doing it because they know this is going to help you. They love you enough to want to see you do different. They want you to be better. And they'll correct your behavior. And you've got to always see God in that kind of light. Everything, even if he's breaking me. What did Job say? He wounds. But his hand makes whole. Boy, y'all getting quiet. I got to stop. But you've got to see it right. The chastening of the Lord is rooted in the fact that God loves you enough to correct you, to rehabilitate you, to change you. Oh, he's not just out to hurt you and punish you. He's trying to correct you. Because when this is over, you got to be a different person. You got to have a different mindset. But you know what? You got some folk that don't want God to lead them. And they don't want him to correct them when they go astray. And you know what the Bible declares? Let me tell you now. I'll be done after this. That those are not the children of God. Ain't that something? Did y'all hear that? You got people don't want him to correct them. And according to the word of God, they walk among the children of God, but those are not the children of God. And what did he say? He said that if you don't endure the chastening of God, then you are bastards and not sons. And we just got to own up to the fact that there are a lot of people in church that don't belong to him. Y'all see me closing my Bible? That's how serious I am about being through. Some people don't belong to him. That's what the word of God declares. They just don't belong to him. Anybody who does not experience the chastening of the Lord is not a son. And that's why we don't focus on how he's dealing with other people. He'll never get them. They get away with everything. I don't know why. They ain't never get it. Look at them. And they doing it. And they got a free conscience. They ain't none bothering them. Why did I can't sleep? And they can go home and do me wrong. And they not even up. But here I am. Can't even go to sleep at night and feel like I got to call. Why I got to call everybody and apologize? They ain't never call me and apologize. Why ain't God keeping them up all night? First of all, be quiet. Like Paul said to the Romans, who are you that replies to God? You can't compare yourself to how God is dealing with somebody else because they might not belong to him. Boy, y'all getting quiet. See, you ought to just thank God that you're a child of God. Why they sleeping at night? Because they don't belong to him. Everybody that belongs to him, he going to whip you every now and then. I don't understand why I'm always crying. Why it's always me. Why I'm always in trouble. Why God always doing it. I don't know why. Every time I come to church, they preaching on this and preaching on that. And I know they don't even know my story. But why God giving the preacher stuff to say about me every time I come. And I know what they doing. And I don't never hear that coming over the pulpit. That's not for you to talk about. Because the reality is, they might not even belong to him. So you got to change how you see this. Anybody that's not corrected don't have a connection to a loving God. Because he would never wink at the faults of his children. Huh. He never would. I'll stop. Stand to your feet, huh? The chastening of the Lord. We're going to get an understanding of this before it's all said and done. The chastening of God. Why does he deal with me like this? Why does he deal with me like this? does it seem like I'm always under the spotlight? Because you're the one that asked them to search you. You saying stuff, well, I keep telling you, the Bible said don't say stuff out of your mouth that's not in your heart. Yeah. You had the nerve to sit up and get on your knees, search me, Lord. And if there's anything in me that's not like you, take it out because I want to be right. And then when God start correcting you, I wonder what I did to make him hate me. In all of our getting, we have to get an understanding. And I think there's enough time between tonight and next Thursday I can say some of this stuff, because some of y'all going to forget about it. And I'm going to use it again next Thursday when I come. But do you know what the goal, and I've said it before, you know what the goal of discipline is, don't you? You know what the goal of discipline is? Self-discipline. The goal of discipline is self-discipline. That's why you discipline your children. So that when you're not around, they'll remember that. And it'll change their behavior, and they won't do that. You know why? When you were going for that plug, your mama hit your hand. Not just to preserve your life. But she couldn't just sit up there, you know what, don't do that. That's not, no. No, that had to be some trick. Get your hand off the. You know why she had to do that? So the next time you reach for that, there would be something in your mind say, mm-mm. You better think hard about that. So the goal of discipline is self-discipline. You know what the psalmist said? Lord, I'm getting to the next Thursday night. He said it was good for me that I was afflicted, because what? I learned your ways. It takes that in order to teach us how to be better after this. And I'm telling you, for every child of God that endures the chastening of God, look at somebody and tell them, we're going to be better after this. Or tell them, we'll be better after this. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Maybe there's somebody here tonight that's not saved. You don't know the Lord in the pardon of your sin. If that's you, I want you to come. If you need to be saved, come on. If you need the Holy Ghost, would you come? Hallelujah. If you have a need, would you come tonight? I'll pray with you if you're here. Hallelujah. Alone.
Search me, Lord.
Please.
Search me, Lord.
Shine a light from heaven on my soul.
Search me, Lord.
Please search me, Lord.
Search.
on here. Shine the light from heaven
on my soul.
Yes.
Be,
come on, Jesus.
Take it out.
Hey, I want to be right.
I want to be right.
I want to be right.
I want to be right. I want to be right.
I
want to
be
right.
I want to, I want to, I want to, I want to.
I want to be right.
I want to be right. Tell him, search my heart, Lord.
I wanna be right.
Tell him, search my mind, Lord.
I wanna be right.
I wanna
be right.
I wanna be right.
I wanna
be right.
I wanna
be right.
I wanna be right.
You can search my mind, Jesus.
I wanna be right.
You can search my heart, Jesus. I wanna be right.
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 Hey,
I wanna be right.
Search me, Lord.
I wanna be right.
Search me, Lord.
I wanna be right.
Shine the light from heaven. Take it out, Lord. I wanna be right. I wanna be saving. I gotta be whole. Hey. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
On Friday night, please join our apostle and the Sherman Full Gospel for the official pastoral installation of Pastor Joshua and Wendy Shelton. This is an official service. We're asking that all ministers please dress in the official black clergy attire, and all others are asked to dress in black. The service will be held at 806 North Grand Avenue there in Sherman at the Chapel there on the Austin College campus. Thank you. Those are all the announcements.
Hallelujah. 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 Yeah, I wanna be right.
I wanna be right.
That's my heart's desire.
I wanna be right.
Lord, I wanna be right.
I wanna be right.
When it's all said and done,
I wanna be right.
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 I wanna be right. Hey, search me, Jesus.
I wanna be right.
Let me see y'all clap your hands, would you?
I wanna be right.
Come on, clap your hands.
I wanna be right. I wanna be right.
Father, take us from this place in your safety and in your care. Lead us and guide us, direct us and protect us as we travel over the dangerous highways. Bring us back at the appointed time with our minds set to lift you in the beauty of holiness. And we'll be so very careful to give your name the praise, the glory, and all the honor. It belongs to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Somebody lift your hands and tell the Lord thank you. Come on, tell him thank you.